I think people can hear us. There's stuff going on. Do you hear the shimmy shake? I'm getting excited. Must mean we're about to go live. All right, I'm going to turn us off for a second. Well, I'm back.
Welcome back, John Dyson.
And I still don't know what I'm doing. So nothing has changed.
Well, welcome back to First Dibs from inside Porsche, Colorado Springs.
Isn't that cool? We're here.
We're here. Yep. It's Thursday.
I know. Isn't that weird?
But we're doing this in celebration of Lauren's birthday.
I know. Yep.
Well, we're not celebrating Lauren's birthday by doing a podcast.
Yeah, we're hanging out by ourselves. My wife's birthday tonight. Decided I didn't want to be there for that. No, her birthday's tomorrow.
That's
so
right.
So we're on early.
How does anyone's birthday fall on a Friday? I don't think I've ever been so lucky.
Doesn't happen.
Wouldn't matter anyway.
No,
I guess I got to be up early. Yep. Come in Saturday.
You could take the day off.
Is Lauren one of those people?
How many days a year do you not use a vacation? I feel like you don't use your vacation.
Well, let's see, 365.
Yeah, but how many do you get?
Days of vacation?
Yeah.
Well, I don't really have quote unquote vacation.
Oh, so that's why you're here.
It's just time, like there's time off. And sure. I want to say,
so could you not work all the time? Is that if you still did your job, you don't have to be here? Or
well, kind of. I mean,
yeah.
So I, you know, for primarily what I do, I could do a lot of it from home.
Yeah,
majority of it actually. Mm-hmm. I got to work on that.
Well,
I work well from home.
You heard it here first.
You heard it here first.
Yeah. Today, Magnus Walker is here. I tried to get to go out to drink with him last week.
But, oh yeah, but he wouldn't go.
No, he was in New York.
Ah.
So I missed him, but okay. we did get to go to see.
Yeah, I've been waiting to hear this. Right, yeah. I've kind of been avoiding you since you got back.
I know. it's more fun when it's on air.
Right. So what did you do?
We had such a good trip.
Good. Well, it was kind of like two trips.
It was
in
two
one.
Trips. It was a mm-hmm. ton. The first part of the trip was brand ambassador training mm-hmm. at the Four Seasons Westlake.
And what is brand ambassador?
A lot of it, I think, for the first one was what do Porsche clients expect? What can they have? You know, they put us up at a Ritz, mm-hmm. and their point was all of your Porsche clients can do this. If they want to do it, they can do it. So mm-hmm. it's really special for you guys. This is the first time a lot of you have been here. This is the first time a lot of you have had, like, mm-hmm. surf and turf and oysters, right? But this is just another day for somebody that can have these Porsches. So. Yep. If this is the level of service that they expect from a restaurant mm-hmm. when they're spending $1,000 on a meal,
right.
What do they expect when they're spending $200,000 on a 911 Turbo?
Yeah.
Which mm-hmm. I thought was really interesting. A little bit of that one was Porsche history as well, learning a little bit about the brand. And
that was
and the first
trip?
That was the first one.
The first one. And where did you do the first?
I did that in Atlanta.
Okay.
Yep. So we were downtown Atlanta at the, I think that's the Ritz-Carlton. Downtown Atlanta, I think is what that's called.
I want to say they used the Four Seasons.
Maybe it was. I don't know.
Anyway.
It was a
nice place.
Excuse me. Nice hotel.
Yeah.
The Four Seasons Westlake kills it, though. Like, I was walking to my room, and it just smelled like eucalyptus, and like lilacs. It was just delightful. You know, you're walking down the hallway, and it's not like last night's leftover room service. It's spa atmosphere. It was just
someone else's food. Laying
out
the hallway.
Yeah, no, none of that. Yeah, and and to the point where it was noticeable. You know, I'm sure that you can do that other places, like walking past mm-hmm. the Bed Bath and Beyond. or whatever that, you know, the Body Works, the lotion place. Remember all that was it. In all yeah, of those stores. All those yeah, but this was like just nice and the right level, and you were just like, mm-hmm. I feel awake and I'm fresh. This yeah. is wonderful. So mm-hmm. everything from that to, you know, the room itself, all of that was fantastic. But the training itself was about kind of how to cater to different personality types,
okay.
And make sure that you know the right way to communicate with somebody. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of this, you know, we can be having the same conversation, but we're not, because neither of us understand what we're talking about,
right?
Which is basically this podcast, right? But the way you say something, how you say something, how to be effective at that, mm-hmm. A lot of kind of tools to help people make decisions on cars. You know, I don't think Porsche as a brand and us in general, I don't think we're high pressure, but, you know, ways to help people understand the differences between us and another dealership, you know, two different Porsches, a Porsche and a BMW, whatever it is, mm-hmm. and kind of mm-hmm. how to respect what the other brands are doing, but
right.
what makes a Porsche different.
Yeah.
So it was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. No, it's awesome. You said you did some live role play with some actors
yeah.
on this
trip. I cheated.
So how do you cheat in live role play?
Okay, so the night the first night they did a little reception with us, where, you know, great food up in this art gallery at the Four Seasons, and the actors were there,
nice.
And the actors were all sitting at their own table. But I got in line behind one of them when he was ordering drinks, and he was talking to another actor, and he was like, "So where are we going out tonight?" And I go, "Yeah, where are we going out tonight?" And they'd both turn and they're like, "Huh?" I'm like, "Are you guys going out? Let's go." And so we end up going out and kind of walking to a neighboring development, had yeah. some beers and everything like that.
They okay.
We had eaten dinner, they had dinner, and we just I got to know all the actors with Andrew from our service team. He was there with me, which
oh,
was
nice.
Really
yeah.
cool. So mm-hmm. you know, I think a lot of the other people in class were a little intimidated by this, because yeah. it's weird, right? You're having fake interactions with people, and
right.
people are trained actors, and you're in there with, it's you and two other people from class, and then there's a person from Porsche that they call an auditor
mm-hmm.
that's like writing on a piece of paper and
right.
taking notes, and then mm-hmm. they're going to send that to your boss
yeah.
about how you did. So it could be intimidating, but
sure.
you know, for me and Andrew, it's like, "Hey, Freddie,
right?
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry you're pissed about your service," but you know, because that's what some of the things were for the service team. It's, you know, you didn't meet expectations for this. This person
yeah.
is a very, you know, assertive personality type. How do you meet their needs moving forward?
Yeah.
Right? And if you've got somebody flying off the handle and you don't know who they are, that's different than
yeah.
I was just out for beers with you last night. So I cheated a little
right,
bit.
Yeah,
but
that's good. That's okay.
Yeah, it worked. And one of the examples, I think, was like a perfect contrast between the service side of the business and the sales side.
Mm-hmm.
The service guy was getting lit up by a client that didn't understand why her brakes squeaked.
Oh.
The car had been in three times. Why are my brakes still squeaking?
Right.
What, you're wasting my time.
Yeah.
And that was his scenario. How do you deal with that? And mine was, you're out at a party and you don't know this guy. And I'm like, "Oh, I can do that. Hey, I'm John.
You guys going to a party?"
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. "How do you know Jeff?" "Oh, that's great." Like, it was just so funny, just the difference between, I think that's not what our service people face, right? They do a mm-hmm. great job. I don't think they get the heat like maybe a lot of other brands and other dealerships and stuff like that, where really you've got people that are neglecting their cars, and you know, you're meeting them with, like, you know, 8 years you haven't had an oil change and now you need new motor.
Right.
Right. That type of thing doesn't really happen here. But the contrast between those two, at least in the scenarios, was really funny. Like, it was pretty enjoyable. So I had a good time with it. I'm excited to see how my scores come back.
Okay.
Yeah.
You actually do see the scores?
I think Ted does.
Okay.
I think they send them back to Ted.
Mm-hmm.
So
nice.
I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah. Well, I hope you're still a brand ambassador at the end of it.
Pretty sure I killed it. So, yeah, I don't know. We'll
All right, see. So that was phase one of your trip.
Yep. So then Lauren flew out met me. She stayed at the Four Seasons for the kind of the last day, and then we went into LA, stayed in West Hollywood. And if anybody's going to LA, I would tell you stay at the Sunset Marquee. It was like just the best. Small hotel, way different than the Four Seasons. Level of service, I think, was right there though. Where the Four Seasons, it's a big grand lobby and everything like that when you walk in. When you walk into the Sunset Marquee, first of all, you're parked on like a 45 degree, you know, I don't know what a grade it is, but it's probably 38% grade hill. You know, and like if you open the trunk, your suitcase rolls out the back. Like seriously, I thought I was in San Francisco, not in LA. It was just totally a different, different area. And then you walk in, low ceilings. There's a little art gallery on the right with pictures of rock stars. And then on the left, there's a bar with like, it probably holds 50 people, something like that. Super, super intimate bar. But while we were there, the guy from Cash Cab.
Oh, yeah.
He was sitting at the bar next to us.
No way.
Yeah. So, and I guess, I think Green Day and The Who were both at the hotel. We didn't see any of them, but the bartenders kind of were like, yeah, you guys just missed these guys. And I was like, oh. So, so that's the whole point of it is like, it's, you're right there with all these like interesting rock stars and, and different people, but you don't care. Because you're just there, and the place is taking such good care of you that you're just one of them, and it was great.
I mean, you were showing me before you left, but the hotel has history with all that.
Oh yeah, yeah. Like since 1963, anybody has stayed there. Any rock star that you can think of has stayed there. They had pictures of like Robin Williams by the pool, and Mick Jagger and Aerosmith. Tina Turner was hanging over the pool. Like it just everybody that's there has stayed there, and they've got kind of the main hotel, which it's kind of a rinky-dink hotel, right? They do a nice job with it, but if that was anywhere else in the country, it's like a little horseshoe hotel with a tiny pool in the middle.
Okay.
Right? But because of the way they take care of you and the way they have the rooms furnished and the people that have been there, it just changes things.
Interesting.
And then we got we got put into a villa.
So, no way.
Yeah, so we weren't in that like the normal hotel. We were like walking through this little jungle path to a room with, we had two rooms and a patio. With a heater.
This is just you and your wife.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. So we had a good time.
You each had your own room.
Yeah. I slept on the couch. She got the bed. Yep.
Oh man. But that sounds like a good time. But then you hung out with Johnny Lieberman.
Yeah. Yep. We got to go to dinner with Johnny and Amy at one of their friends' restaurants. The story of how they met was kind of fun. They were at like a friend's barbecue, and the friend had made chicken and it was good. But then Johnny tried the fish and he was like, oh my God, this is delicious. Who made this? And it was like, oh, that guy. And oh, Michael, this fish is delicious. You should try being a chef. And then later he found out like the dude already had one Michelin star. So like, yeah, I tried that. I'm pretty good at it. I'm glad you liked it. But yeah.
Yep. That's amazing. Yep,
we've got that going on. And now the guy has another Michelin star.
Wow.
And has Providence, LA is the name of the restaurant. And we had like this, I didn't count, but it was probably 20 courses.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That's wild.
It was really good. And all of them like just bites.
Sure.
You know, you'd have a bite and
moose bouche.
Yeah. A couple times I had to like close my eyes and put my head on the table because it was like having a moment. There was one, it was like some kind of cracker with scrambled eggs and truffles on top. And it was the best bite I had all night. It was stupid.
Scrambled eggs.
Scrambled eggs with truffles.
And
yeah.
Dirt mushrooms.
Yep.
Nice.
Yeah, here.
Interesting.
Hold on, let me see if I can.
It sounds like a pretty fascinating night, though. I mean, 20 courses would take a while.
Yeah, we were there for 3.5 hours.
Wow.
I think. And
each course comes paired with a drink?
The wine throughout. Yeah, okay. So we didn't get 20 different wines. But but yeah, we did have we did have a bunch here. I'll show you.
Yeah, that sounds pretty fascinating, though.
Yeah, this is the picture Lauren took of the plate.
Oh, that's so fantastic. Those are the crackers with scrambled eggs?
Yeah, exactly. And then uni on the other one. So we each got one of each of those.
Oh, okay. I would have given you my uni.
Nope. You would have loved it. Seriously. It was, they FedEx it in from Japan.
Oh, well, so, FedEx.
Yeah.
In an envelope.
Uh-huh.
Cool.
Yep. But, yeah.
I love sushi. And yeah. I'll give a plug to my buddy Andy, John Holly's Asian Bistro. He has the restaurant on Downing in Denver. It's near Porter Hospital. And I absolutely love sushi. Uni's the one. Like, it's the one.
It's out there.
That I have the hardest time with.
Yep. I made Andrew try some when we were at training. We went out. We got tacos on Taco Tuesday. And then I was still hungry because I'm a fat kid. And there was a sushi restaurant across the parking lot. Mm-hmm. So we went over there and I ordered some uni and I made him try it. And he didn't check out. So more power to you, buddy.
Right.
Yeah. That stuff's weird, though.
Yeah.
You know, it can be so like iodine and ocean and stuff.
And
it can be weird.
Sea urchin. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yep.
Okay.
The gonads of the sea urchin.
Right.
I don't know what a gonad is. I don't want to. Yep.
That reminds me, my son had a project due today in history.
Okay.
Some kind of specific history class that they're in. Anyway, I asked him, what's your project got to be? And he said, well, this is actually kind of interesting. He said, we have to do a presentation. And it's on food.
I like food.
So, really? Tell me more. He said, well, to get the project started, our teacher said, I want you to pair up and choose a food. Any food. It could be any food that you think of. But he didn't, the teacher didn't give any backstory, didn't describe what you're going to be doing, right? Pair up, choose a food. Anyway, Preston and his partner, hot dogs, because why not?
Right? Okay. Yep.
Well, anyway. So what it turns into is you have to give a presentation on the food, where it comes from, how it's made, and then you actually have to serve it to the class.
Okay.
You have to give examples. So anyway, they chose hot dogs. And I mean, instantly, ideas are rolling through my head, you know, because there was a period of my life that I really enjoyed public speaking. Right, I think you've mentioned that you're very good at it. You like doing that.
You know what I'm not good at is planning it out. But if it's an impromptu speech, crush it. I'm making it up.
Well, my dad did a fantastic job with me when I was in, I think it was eighth grade, and it was a big moment where I had to give like a 20-minute presentation in class. It was a huge project, and the life lesson that came of it was you have to capture people's attention right away, right? Yep. Just right off the bat. You got to get their attention somehow, and then they will listen to you. And so ever since then, I've just kind of carried that, and it obviously it works, right? That's a thing for doing public speaking. And when my son says that they have to do a presentation on hot dogs, I mean, all kinds of ideas, right? And I'm describing, because he's heard me say this before, get people's attention, all that kind of stuff. I said, buddy, if you stand at the front of the class and you start your speech, your presentation with hot dogs, lips and assholes.
That's kind of where I was going. Yeah. I like
right. I said, you will have everybody paying attention to you.
Absolutely.
Even the teacher might turn a little white.
Yep.
But everyone will listen to every word that comes out of your mouth.
Yep.
So anyway, I'm kind of excited. That happened to the project was due today. We made, there's 20 kids in class. So we actually made 10 hot dogs last night, cut them in half, wrapped them in foil. I told Preston, I said, hey, if your teacher happens to ask, when did you make these? Your answer is going to be this morning.
Sure.
They were wrapped in aluminum foil. They were put in the fridge. I mean, they're soup, they're hot dogs, right? I mean, they're safe. They're sure. Oscar Mayer or whatever. Yeah. They're safe. But, anyway, I just envisioned like this might go over really well. So I'm super curious to hear, you know, how it ended up. But, anyway, I don't know how I got started on that. I think it was
uni.
Uni.
Yeah.
Uni and hot dogs. Oh, gonads.
Gonads. Yeah, there you go. Yep. Same basic plan. But go check out that restaurant if you're ever there. It was an experience.
Yeah.
It was pretty cool.
So back to business. We're here at First Dibs.
We are.
We're all caught up with what the Dicey's been doing here for the last week.
Yeah, who cares anyway?
Everybody listening.
I hope so.
Yeah.
And
So some big news. You've got it on your monitor here. I'm not sure if the people on YouTube can see it.
Hold on, they will in a second. I'm going to bring it up. Let's do it like that and like that. Yeah.
But the 911 Dakar is official.
Yeah.
And it's on the configurator.
How cool, huh?
So you can hop on Porsche's Build Your Porsche website.
Yep.
And build your own. Have you played with this at all?
No. I looked at it.
I did for about 30 seconds.
Yeah.
And got called away to do something else.
That thing, it's so beyond what I was expecting.
So, okay, now that could go different ways.
Uh-huh.
50-50, right? Are you blown away as in you're impressed, or you're blown away as in like,
I'm impressed. I'm really impressed.
Are you?
Yeah. I was expecting a lift kit.
Okay.
You know, mm-hmm. like a lifted 911.
Right.
This is more than that. Mm-hmm. The front end is different than any other 911.
Right.
It doesn't have active aero.
Right.
Because you're going to break it.
Yeah.
If you're going off-road.
You're jumping it.
Yeah. So so skip all of that.
Right.
Obviously, it's got roof rack accessories that you can put on it.
Right.
But they put a 12-volt outlet in the roof. So you can power your lights.
Right.
Like, that's really cool.
That's pretty good.
I was thinking, you know, maybe they put it on air suspension so they can raise it up and down. But they didn't. They put like a front axle lift on the front and rear axles.
Okay.
But on a normal 911, at what, 30? The front lift goes back down somewhere in there, 27 or 42.
I think it's actually like 34.
Yeah. Somewhere in there.
Mm-hmm.
This will do, 105 miles an hour?
In the raised position.
Up. Yeah.
Right.
And like, I just think that's so cool. Special tires they built just for this car.
Right.
I was thinking, you know, they'll put on some all season.
Yeah. Right.
GTS power. Mm-hmm. But with smaller brakes.
Yep.
Because it's limited to 150 miles an hour. I think this is the first car Porsche has limited the top speed of.
Right.
And it's all tire based where normally they put a sticker on that says, don't go over 150. Right. This thing, I think you would go over 150 and then your tires would explode.
Right. The tires are probably only good for, you know, 120.
Yeah. Well, it's 150. I think they got it, but. Mm-hmm. I love it. I think it's really cool. It'll do Nürburgring, on pace with a 996 GT3.
Hmm. Oh, wow. That's
so
pretty good.
It's not as quick on the Nürburgring as the Cayenne Turbo GT.
Right.
But I bet it's a lot more fun.
Yeah.
And I love that thing, too.
And the Cayenne Turbo GT is not necessarily like an off-road car, right?
Yep.
So,
exactly.
No, I mean, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah. It's kind of flipping the script, right? The Turbo GT is a track toy that just happens to be an SUV.
Right.
And then this is an ultimate off-roader that is still as fast as a 996 GT3 on the Nürburgring. It's wild.
Yeah.
It's so cool. Yeah.
So if you go through it where people can see, I played with it, like I said, for about 30 seconds and there's a couple things that I really dug about it. There's a couple things I thought, see, like right here, that's the rally package, right? Mm-hmm. They're kind of, if you ask me, they're kind of forcing you to do that in a way because
it's so awesome.
Yeah, exactly. That's just badass, right?
That car gets hand painted.
Mm-hmm. Right.
For 7.5 hours.
The rally edition.
This one does. Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And then another 8.5 hours of pinstriping.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And the total time to paint it, 34.5 hours. Right. That includes like rolling through the production line, getting painted, getting the white gets painted first, I think, and then the gentian blue gets hand painted after that. And then they do all of the striping and everything.
Right.
But I love it. There's a couple things they haven't really announced yet, but we got to see in the launch information.
Yep.
They're going to do a couple wraps. So you can do three different wraps, a 71, 74, and 78 rally wrap.
Okay.
That are based on different rally cars of those eras.
Mm-hmm.
I've only seen small little thumbnails of it, but it'd be a way to kind of get this look for not $38,000.
Right.
Because I think it's 28 for this, and then
28.
You'd have to add the extra interior,
right?
The fancy interior if you did it too.
Now this came up though as I was going through full buckets
with standard.
It.
Yeah,
Or you could do
18 ways.
18 ways.
Yep.
What would personally, what would you do?
I don't know. I'd be if the buckets were hinged, it'd be buckets hands down.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, part of the fun of this, even though I can't put back seats in it, I think there's like a transmission cooler or something like that, or differential cooler that they put in the back. Mm-hmm. That means it took up all the space of the rear seat. So you can't put back seats back in it.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I'd do the 18 ways.
I put 18 ways in it.
Yeah. I just...
The harsh reality of it is I'm never going to take it, you know, through the desert, right?
Yeah.
You know? And I mean like through the desert.
Yeah.
You know? I'm never going to do that.
Yep.
Well, I'm not buying one of these cars. Right
God, now. Don't you wish you could though?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, it's super cool.
All right. So we're... Let's just build one.
Well, and people that don't know what this is, the first time they see one on the street, they're going to think someone highly modified this car.
Yeah.
They're not going to have any clue that that's actually how it rolled out of the factory.
You know, I like that they did some stuff. When we were talking about what would we want to build, when we were talking about the T, I said do a carbon hood.
Yes.
They did.
Mm-hmm.
They did that here. So good job, Porsche.
Yeah.
I know that was a last-minute addition because I mentioned it.
Thanks for listening to the show.
Yeah. We appreciate you guys over there in Stuttgart. If you want to drop off any like prototypes for us to test,
we'll do it.
Mm-hmm. Ask all our clients.
Yeah.
We're good at test driving and finding
right
shakes and rattles and
yeah
and things like that. Went for a ride in a client's Targa.
Mm-hmm.
We were talking about how it had a couple more rattles than he thought it should, and the suspension felt a little harsh. I was like, pull over for a second. Mm-hmm. Let's check your tire pressure.
Ah.
They were like 6 PSI high in the back. So we dropped it down instantly, way better.
Interesting.
So if you think your car is kind of a little bangy,
yeah,
check the tire pressures.
Interesting. Kind of like checking the ground.
Fun fact. Tire pressures and ground wires. Those are the two things I know how to do. Yep, exactly.
No, that's great.
Sometimes I'm right.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen often.
Mm-hmm.
Would you paint your wheels a different color?
I'd make them white.
Okay. What color would you do the car?
I would have to do the package.
Like that? Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Because I was playing around with the colors. I love
gray.
Yeah.
Shade green. Shade green.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I like the, what is it, Icelandic? What's that called?
Ice gray metallic?
Ice gray. I like that color.
Yeah, I hope they open up the shade green to more cars.
Right, totally.
That looks like, that'd be a great Carrera T color.
Mm-hmm.
Totally kind of
different
and classic.
Yeah, but I like the Rally.
Yep.
So I'd have to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Automatic $28,000 upgrade.
Yep.
The wheels are in white. The
wheels come white. Okay, cool.
I would do the 18-way seats.
Okay. And then extended Rally design package.
Yeah.
You need more Rally leather and stuff.
No, you got to do that. And then this is as far as I made it. I didn't make it any.
Well,
that's
all you really need. So, what's your number? What number are you putting on the side?
Not 953.
Okay.
So, I mean, I'm super partial to the 959 Rothman Dakar.
Yep.
So, I'd probably do 959.
Okay.
If I could choose that. Let's see.
Carbon roof?
Would that eliminate your package?
Let's see. Yep. Kills your package. Carbon roof just kills your package. All right. Moving on. You need the 911 Dakar puddle light indicators. You can't? Oh, my God. Maybe they come standard in the package.
No, they have, what's it called? It's like rough road. They come with a rough road lamp.
That shoots
rough
down?
Roads. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So it's got like a tire tread. Tire track going through the mud.
Well, that's cool. I haven't seen that yet.
Let's see here. What else?
Look
at that
thing. Oh, here's the decal sets. Yeah. So there's the martini.
There's the wraps.
The martini wrap.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the 71.
Okay. Speaking of the wraps and liveries and stuff, my son, another story about him, he wants to get into karting.
Okay.
I don't know if we've already talked about this.
No, not really.
It's super recent. But anyway, we've been to an actual kart race just so we could see kind of the grand scale of things. And then, ironic, just the other day, I was talking to Joe, our GM, and mentioned, yeah, my son is, you know, wanting to get into karting. He said, no way. His daughter, his 13-year-old daughter, is wanting to get into it. So both Joe and I, without really knowing about it, we both have been doing a ton of research, talking to people about it. And I mentioned, hey, if it got to that point, I was actually going to bring up, what would you think about doing a Porsche Colorado Springs livery on a go-kart? He's like, what? Hell yeah.
Yeah. He said, is it yellow? Okay.
It might be.
Yeah, it'd have to be.
So what I was thinking, though, a couple different ones would be almost like a 919 livery or the intelligent performance type livery or even what's the green and purple the 70s like the 76 car that what it was I forget what they called it, but anyway, something like that would be a standout. You know,
metallic green and metallic purple,
something wild. Like that would be super awesome. But I mean, in my brain, I'm already, you know, designing suits, you know, and I love, like, we put it on the back of Colorado Springs Lifestyle Magazine, the ad that we have there on the back of that. It's the whole back cover. But I think it was it must have been June's edition that came out. The ad was our Pikes Peak Hill Climb car, and David Donner's walking towards it. And so he's got his helmet on, his suit on, everything. Well, anyway, on his left butt cheek is a Colorado flag in the shape of a heart, right? And I just thought, now that's awesome. I would totally have that done, right? You know, my kid's race suit.
I like that. Yep.
It's just something. It's one of those things, right? It grabs your attention, you know, like, what is that? And it's just, but it grabs your attention in a good way, like in a cute way. Like, it's just, it's like, oh, that's pretty funny, you know? It can't be. You can't offend anybody with that. It's really good.
Yep.
But anyway, the Dakar. Yeah, I mean, yeah. Just looking at it right there, I just don't.
I'm gonna put surround view on it because if I'm off road on a mountain, I want to see how far I am from falling off the edge. Yep.
Probably not a bad idea.
I'm gonna do a heated seat. Yep. Heated steering wheel.
That as well.
Fire extinguisher, 100%.
Yep.
I think that's probably it.
Yeah, I think that's pretty good. Look at all the stuff you can choose from, though.
So the question is...
Ooh, delivery. Can you take delivery at Dakar?
Yeah, that'd be cool. They need to do that. Oh, and Burmester. We need Burmester.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. So for $261, do you do this or a GT3 RS?
I would actually drive the Dakar.
Yeah. I'd pick that. I wouldn't spec it exactly like you did, but I would absolutely do one of these.
Yep. That's a great question, though. A new GT3 RS or a Dakar? So the GT3 RS, Dakar, they're making 2,500 worldwide, is that right?
Yep. I bet the new GT3 RS isn't much bigger than that.
Sure. No, you're right. Yeah, that stuff's all about to get real interesting. So... No, that's a great question.
Thanks. I asked it.
So I might have to ask our viewers, you know, between, or even on Instagram, right? You can hit us up on Instagram on the First Dibs Instagram page, you know, for the money, would you rather go GT3 RS?
Yeah, even money.
Even money.
Spec it however you want.
Yeah.
Even money, which one do you pick?
Yeah. No, that's great. That's a really good one. Interesting. No, so I mean, that's some huge news, which takes away from the GT3 RS.
Here's what I'm hoping. They came out with the R, ultra limited, and then they made the GT3 Touring.
Right.
Which is not the same car, but gets you pretty close. I'm hoping that's what happens with this.
Okay.
Where they make this, and then there's a checkbox you can put on a Carrera 4 or a Carrera 4S or a Carrera 4 GTS, and it gives you the bumper, the underfloor protection, and the suspension and the brakes from that.
Interesting. Okay.
Because to me, spending the development money that they did on getting that ready for just 2,500 units, I mean, obviously they made the 918, and they only made 918 of those, but those were $1 million a piece.
Yeah.
And that was a decade ago. Right. Like money is different now. So even though these are $250,000 a piece, I would think some of the suspension work that you've done mm-hmm. and the development work, you might want to kind of pass down into
right.
other models.
Right.
Yeah. So maybe 992.2, mm-hmm. they'll do something like that.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. Yeah, that's a good point. That's a ton of development.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, Porsche is the endurance racing company, right? So obviously this stuff has been out there for a while that they've been testing. But to think of some different uses that they could put it on or use it for. Yeah, that is good. I guess we're going to find out.
Yep. We will find out. Someday we will find out.
Yeah.
In the next, I don't know, 2 years. Right. But I just think it's fun to work for a company that can do stuff like this. You know, it.
Yeah.
That's just Porsche saying, let's have fun.
Yeah, right.
That's the Germans mm-hmm. being like, hey. Ha ha ha. Look what we can do. Lamborghini's doing one too.
The off-road?
Yeah, an off-road Huracan.
Oh, that's kind of fun. I think I did see something on that just yesterday.
Yep.
Now that you say that.
I think that'll be pretty cool.
Yeah. And Lamborghini, besides the Urus, they did have an SUV.
Yeah.
Was that in the 90s?
LM002. Yep.
Yeah. Which was super boxy. It was kind of a Land Rover. Like an old school Land Rover.
It was a good looking truck.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I only saw one of those in the flesh.
I don't think I've ever seen one.
I saw a white one, and it was parked in Denver.
Mm-hmm.
That was a long, long time ago.
5-speed and a Countach motor.
Really? That's
mm-hmm.
what's in it?
Mm-hmm.
I did not know that.
Yep.
But it was funny because I just remember being super boxy, and at first glance, I thought it was just an old...
It's like an Italian Hummer.
Right? Right. But supposedly they were great trucks, really good trucks, very capable.
Definitely
off-road cars.
I think the tires from that, like they make once a decade, or something like that.
Really?
They've got sidewalls that like flare out, so the tread like rests on the sand, but then they have shoulders that also hold it up. So
interesting.
When you're on sand, you get kind of a little extra
interesting
cushion.
Hmm.
Might be real, might be not. I don't know. I might have made that up.
Right. Someone needs to fact check this.
Fact check. Fact check, Mr. Deisty.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Aisle three.
Yeah. What else is coming up?
We got a couple Cayenne Turbo GTs.
That's right. We have a chalk one.
The chalk one. We never debuted that on the show. You guys were a little early. But also, I got to say thank you to Nancy and Danny.
That's right.
You guys did a great job last week. I didn't get to watch the whole thing because I was busy running to my 4 million course dinner. But the start of it, I think, was awesome. Good job with the mustaches. excited to get to give this thing up, my little control pad at some point. Mm-hmm. So nice work there. Mm-hmm. Nancy, you can get a hold of at 719-219-5044. Just make sure you say John sent you. I've given up on trying to scrape those away. But no, really, good job, everybody. That was fun. It's nice to be able to take time off and know that, you know, our clients are in good hands, my clients are in good hands, and then my little baby, this show.
Right.
You know, obviously you're going to do a great job, but to have people that can come in and fill in and, you know.
And they want to.
Yeah.
That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, very much.
Yeah. It it's taxing if you have to ask someone.
Mm-hmm.
And granted, you still ask, right?
Yeah.
But, oh, yeah. I mean, the initial response, you know. Mm-hmm.
It's not like, wait, what are you doing? You want me to do what?
Oh, man.
Yeah, really? On Friday night?
Is it really?
Yeah.
Is it my turn?
Are you going to pay me? Yeah. No. I think that was really cool. Really interesting to watch it, too.
Oh, I bet.
Because I've never watched one.
Yeah.
You know, we just record this, and I've listened to a bunch of our shows and things like that, and I've watched bits of a YouTube episode, but I've never watched it live happening.
Right.
So that was really kind of interesting, I think.
Apparently no one else is either.
Nobody knows. We got 3 people watching right now.
Oh, that's pretty good.
5 people were watching at some point on a day we didn't even know we were going on.
Yeah, that's right.
My notes, I think, are when we're doing the QVC for cars.
Yeah.
We both need microphones.
Yeah, for sure.
So we'll get that fixed. We're not going to do it this week, just to kind of plan and move forward. And I think,
reload.
And I think some little transitions. Mm-hmm. So we've got something to fill the air while we are, maybe we could do ads. If we got some sponsors, we could do some ads and we could fill them in between segments.
Right.
And we could have pre-recorded bits that we could do.
That's right.
And they could be 15 or 30 seconds long. Or if you got deep pockets, you could have a minute. And we'll record them for you. You can put them wherever you want. Mm-hmm. But we could do that.
Yeah.
And I think we need to put the hard push on for studio space.
Mm-hmm.
I like our setup over here, but I think we can improve it
for
the listeners and the viewers. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, no, I know we can. That's awesome.
I thought great job, everybody. So,
well, good.
Well done.
Yeah, good things to come in the near future. Mm-hmm. You know, here hopefully.
Yeah.
I'm looking outside and it's snowing. Mm-hmm. Right. You know, for all the people that are in their warm, cozy, you know, homes watching this, the times are a changing, John.
Mm-hmm.
The times.
Should we see if we can show people? Yeah.
So one thing that I kind of was thinking about bringing up is, as a very recent, we still want to buy cars every day, right? And obviously we love trades, things like that. There's definitely been a shift of momentum, and it's not in all brands of cars, but it is in most brands of cars, and we're certainly starting to see it in the Porsche world as mm-hmm. well. I've seen it in off-brand cars, Audis, BMWs, Land Rovers, Mercedes, Toyotas, not as much Toyotas. They're pretty consistent, actually. But a lot of brands of cars. There's been a kind of a drastic change here in the last, let's call it 60 days mm-hmm. or so. But there hasn't been a huge drastic change in what people look up online, you know, as far as their valuation tools, mm-hmm. stuff like that. But we're going to just see more and more of it. And mm-hmm. what's happening is people that are contacting us that have been holding out, they're kind of being stunned, shocked, surprised, you know, as far as what has changed in the last 2 months' time. Some of it is pretty crazy different, you mm-hmm. know, what's happened. I think Porsche, for the most part, is affected the least amount, and we're always affected last for some reason. Mm-hmm. So our transition is just it's being delayed, but
we're still doing stuff though.
We're still doing stuff.
Being market driven, we're watching the market. I think there was a client that I had. He's looking at Cayman GTS mm-hmm. that we have, the red one,
mm-hmm.
And he. He was in a rear end collision in one of his cars. It was taking time to get the gap payout done, so mm-hmm. he couldn't buy anything yet.
Sure.
And in the 3 weeks I've been talking to him, we've made an adjustment in our car.
Okay.
So he actually mm-hmm. he's coming out a little bit ahead because you know mm-hmm. the market has moved and and we have too. And I think you know a little bit. I think people are going to be afraid. You know, you'll look at Kelly Blue Book and see your trade value is X.
Right.
And then we come back at you and say, well, the Kelly Blue Book is looking at, you know,
60 days ago.
Second quarter.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. It's a little different now.
Right.
But the good news is the delta mm-hmm. probably hasn't changed that much. You know, your car's worth a little bit less. We're asking a little bit less for our car.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Right. It's exactly right. And that's why it's so important to be market driven and market focused as mm-hmm. far as with everything that we're doing, whether it's buying or selling, is that everything just kind of rises and falls together.
Mm-hmm.
It's it's a lesson, right? Not one person is bigger than the market.
Yep.
The market is the market. It's going to tell you, you know, where things need to be and where they are. And we're not above that. We're not below it.
Yeah.
So we rise and we fall with it.
Yep.
So that's a great point. You know, the delta between the two, it's not really changing. So yeah, people are kind of surprised, you know, as far as what's happening when they're just flat out selling a car, mm-hmm. you know, here recently it's, well, you know, you know, you asked about selling it 6 months ago, like, you know, just wait and see what's going to happen. Well, now your
timing would have been right then.
Now you're seeing what's happening.
Mm-hmm. You know, I wonder a little bit, you know, you've got, I think every time an election comes around, there's nerves.
Sure.
Anytime the Fed is raising rates, there's nerves.
Yeah.
You know, anytime there's talk of recession, there's nerves.
Absolutely.
But this doesn't feel any different to me, really, than like a typical kind of fall winter.
Right.
You know, it's just over the last few years, it's just been this kind of slash upward.
Right.
And at this point, I think we're just kind of back to normal. And the you look outside and it's snowing. Sports car season for a lot of the nation is done.
Yeah.
Until March, April.
Right.
And that's what happens. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're just all kind of seeing that a little bit.
Sure.
So we'll see what happens. I can't predict the future.
I am a giant advocate, though. We sell a 911 on every snow day.
Oh, yeah. They're great. I look at the one we were just talking about. That's right. The thing. The platform's the same.
Mm-hmm.
You put maybe not those crazy knobby off-road tires
right.
on your 911, but you put winters on it and drive it all the time.
Absolutely.
I would.
Yeah.
I'm sad I can't.
We have a local client that we've done a lot of business with, and he actually just purchased back a 911 that he sold us a while ago. And he's someone that puts winter tires on all of his cars.
Yep.
Even though he doesn't plan on driving them in the snow, it's just in the event.
The cold.
Yeah. If he gets caught, if he decides to go drive it on a cold day,
yep.
he wants to be safe, all that kind of stuff. What I love about it is he does wheel and tire sets.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just swapping rubber over, which you can
yep.
do easily, and that's what majority of people do. That's what I personally would do. But he has wheel and tire sets for all these things.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's fantastic. You know, seeing a GT3 come in, a 911R come in, you know, with snow tires, right? You know,
yeah.
installed
at
Turbo
so cool.
S.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Dan McInnes says he wants us to get better internet.
Oh, okay.
We're not uploading fast enough.
Oh, okay.
So he's got a buffer. Sorry, Dan.
Well, help us out, Dan.
Yeah, I know. He's the guy. Yeah. We'll get it. Tell us what we need.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We'll put the push in.
Well, that's good. Mm-hmm. At least
he's going to hear that in about 30 minutes as things buffer up.
No, I agree with you. Because, yeah, I've been seeing this error that we're not... Mm-hmm. What does it say here?
YouTube is not receiving enough video to maintain smooth streaming.
Oh, okay. So we need to be more active.
No, we just need better internet. We'll work on it.
All right.
Yep.
Well, what do we have left? Is there anything new and exciting that's coming up? Fresh inventory. You haven't been around.
I know. I'm really excited for the M3.
Yeah.
I think you guys did a nice job talking about that car.
Yep.
I think it's a 3.2 liter, not a 3.6.
Oh, did I say 3.6?
No, I think Nancy said 3.6.
Okay.
But it's an E36, which is correct.
Correct.
Initially, they launched with a 3 liter, and then later they got the 3.2.
Yep.
I haven't driven that yet, but I just think they're stunning. A little bit, it's tough because if I bought it, I'd want to drive it, but that's like a collector piece.
It is now.
And that's what's kind of unfortunate. And when I bought my Volvo, what I should have done is bought one of those. That would have satisfied my itch. It could have been my only car. I'd have 250,000 miles on it now, and it'd still be worth the $25,000 I paid for it then.
Right.
And so,
yeah,
you know, oops.
Yeah, no, that car, I mean... The more I learn about it, it is super cool.
Mm-hmm.
Forged lightweight wheels. Of course, having all the Dinan stuff that was put on by the Enthusiast Auto Group. That's pretty awesome. The mirrors. I love the mirrors for some
reason. Those are good, aren't they?
I think those are so quirky.
Yep.
That would never be put on a German car today.
They're itty-bitty.
Yeah, nothing
like that.
But
they're homologation stuff, right?
Sure.
If you put them on that car, then you've got less drag on your race car.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Here, let's...
No, it's
I don't think any
cool.
of our shots have it. Let me just give you a little less Justin. Sorry. There you go. Oh, yep. There you go. Now you can catch at least the back end
right.
of it.
Yeah, see the big Dinan badge there on the left rear.
Yeah.
No, it's a stunning car. It's gorgeous. A great color combination.
Mm-hmm.
Hellrot red.
Yep.
With dove gray leather interior.
I think I've mentioned this before, but the first manual transmission car I ever drove, it was a day like this.
Hmm.
My dad and I went to Borton Volvo in Minneapolis.
Okay.
That location is now closed. Now they only have the Golden Valley location, but they had a Dakar yellow, oddly. I think it was a 95 M3 coupe manual.
Okay.
And my dad took it out And then he was like, "You want to try?" I was like, "What?" Because I'd never driven one. We were just, you know, kind of having fun. And I was like, "Okay." And so he's like, "Okay, just give it a little gas, and then let the clutch out slowly." And I like barely touch the thing and then drop the clutch and it stalls. And he's like, be a little easier on the clutch and give it a little more gas. Right. So I floored it and did the same thing with the clutch in weather like this, in an icy Minnesota. Yeah. It was probably February.
Right.
And we just lit up the rear wheels. And oh my God, what a thing. And then the one we should have bought was a little bit later. They call it an M345. So it's an M3 four-door with a 5-speed.
Oh, wow.
Black on black on black.
Right.
I think it was $38,000 back in probably... It was probably in 97 and in 99, something like that. And mm-hmm. God, that car was so good. And, you know, to me, I love those cars in sedan form. I would want the four-door version because then it just, the back seats actually in that are pretty usable.
Yeah.
But just, you know, my world, how easy can I get my kids in and out?
Yeah,
Is part of it.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
Yep.
No, that's a big thing with that car is the coupe versus the sedan.
Yeah.
There is a tremendous difference.
Which one drives more value?
The coupe does.
Does it really?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I'm a value shopper. I'm not going to get the automatic.
Oh, oh, wait, no. Well, no, I'm sorry. I'm backwards. The sedan would be like the quote unquote value car.
Yeah, that's what I want. Yeah, we're speaking the same language. Yeah, the coupes drive more, are worth more.
Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay. Brandon's wondering, what are we seeing with rates? They're climbing just kind of like they do with the Fed. Every time the Fed brings it up, ours kind of do too. So, you know, I think in terms of historic values, I think rates are still probably pretty good. They're lower than when I bought my first car.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. So,
I mean, I guess what are we, you know, estimating people if they're coming in, if let's say they're financing a $60,000 car that's 4 years old and they're going to do it for 60 months.
Probably mid to upper six.
Okay, that's what we're seeing. That's pretty common.
Somewhere in there.
Yeah, 649, 699, something like that. Which, compared to 5 years ago or whatever.
My first car loan was 8.24, and I had a 700 credit score.
Sure. Yeah.
So it's still pretty great.
Yeah. No, absolutely. No, that's a great question. Thank you, Brandon.
Yep.
Appreciate you asking that. They are still climbing a little bit. We seem to be getting adjustments from Porsche Financial.
Mm-hmm.
Monthly, just about.
Well, and that's what the Fed's kind of doing too.
Yeah,
is they're moving them up and up and up. Right. But I think I don't give financial advice. I don't know what I'm talking about. But you know, I've seen some things that have said like the things that are showing that maybe we were, you know, there was rampant inflation or there was inflation going on. Mm-hmm. Those are kind of getting tucked away.
Yeah.
Right. If we're seeing the car market kind of slow down, that's what they've been trying to do with all of this.
Right.
So. If prices on cars are slowing down, the upward trend and rates, what they've been doing is working.
Yeah,
so
right.
I'm hopeful that maybe we're nearing a peak, and
sure.
then it'll just level for a while, and
right.
don't have to worry. But
yeah,
don't take your financial advice from an idiot on YouTube. That's me and everybody else. So. Right? I mean...
Very much so.
Yeah.
If it's on the internet, it doesn't have to be true.
Yeah, no, exactly. So at training, part of one of the things was like, these are the different ways you can learn. Mm-hmm. And one of them was podcasts. And that was assigned to my table. And so I'm like, okay, well, guys, I have a podcast. One thing I'd like you to know is the barrier to entry is not that high because I have a podcast. Also, listen to me right now. I can say whatever I want. So if you're listening to a podcast, just take it with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I think there's a lot of great ones out there. There's a lot of stuff we listen to. I think we do a pretty good job.
Yeah.
The steering committee guys, they just had JJ Collier on their show.
Yeah.
Really, really interesting. The guy was a snowboarder. And then started fashion design and designed for Spider and Ralph Lauren, and then now has his own brand. And I thought that was a really cool show.
Sure.
Just kind of listening to and getting to know that dude. So super interesting. There's a lot of great content out there, but it was just kind of funny. Like, just be careful because I've got a microphone.
Right.
Now I am Mr. Worldwide. So be careful.
No, that's pretty good. That's that's great sound advice.
Yeah. I don't know what drove us there. But don't take it financial advice from us.
Yeah, no, do not.
Yeah, no. Mm-mm. We like cars.
We're salespeople.
If you're gonna come here and say, should I buy this car? Yes, you should.
You should.
Yes,
today,
you should.
Right now.
Yep. Sign here.
That's right. Press hard. Uh-huh. There's three copies.
What I would do is I would ask you, what about that car excites you?
There you go.
You know,
mm-hmm.
What else do you think about that?
Yeah, right. And then me as a sales manager, when you come into my office and you say, this just isn't right for this guy. You know what I say? John, you can't fix stupid.
That's fair.
If they don't buy it from you, they're going to buy it from someone else.
Well, they're not going to buy that. I hope. 719-209-5044. If I can't sell it to you, ask for Nancy.
Oh my gosh, yeah. No, we've just offered the wrong kind of advice. So anything else? Anything on your mind? No, Thanksgiving's coming up.
Yep.
Right around the corner, which means Christmas is coming right around the corner.
Yeah.
Please tell me you have not put up your Christmas decorations.
I have not.
Good.
Lauren put up a fall wreath on our door.
Okay. I was about to say, are you pushing blame on Lauren right now?
No.
All right.
So yeah, we've got that going on.
Mm-hmm. Because I'm seeing that stuff all over now.
Yeah, we've got a few in our
Christmas trees, mm-hmm. Christmas lights.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little early. Like a week.
It's a little early.
A little week early.
Big plans for Thanksgiving?
I have no idea. We bought a turkey.
Ah.
Thank you, Joe.
Yeah, thanks, Joe.
And we bought peanut oil so we can deep fry it.
You're going to fry it?
Yep. I think that's the only way. It makes me a little sad because I don't get the turkey drippings, so I can't make a gravy.
Gravy. Mm-hmm.
But
yeah,
the turkey ends up being so good that store-bought gravy is fine.
Yeah. They make giant like turkey air fryers now. Have you seen that?
No.
I was researching one just the other day.
Interesting.
It is kind of cool, actually. Mm-hmm. No oil.
Yep.
Right? It's a giant air fryer, basically. So you can also do other things in it. They give you attachments, ribs, you know,
my
chicken
oven
wings.
Is an air fryer.
That's cool.
Yeah, but I've never tried it.
Yeah, you should.
Mm-hmm.
It's much healthier.
Sure. Because there's one thing that John Deisty cares about. It's health food. Healthy lifestyles right here. Eat your vitamin D. Get your vitamin C. And just lots of vegetables, right? Yeah.
Something like that.
Somebody needs to put a stop to this.
And we have reached that 58-minute mark here in about 20 seconds. So you got your song picked out?
I did for the opening, but I played the wrong one. So that's about right. We were supposed to play Sandstorm,
right?
Which, if you haven't heard it, it sounds like this. Hold on. Let's try this here. Because...
of the Dakar.
Exactly. It's a Sandstorm.
Mm-hmm.
This is definitely an earworm. But I hit the wrong one because I'm an idiot.
That's all right.
Na-na-na-na-na.
We can either go out.
I was a little early. No. That's what I was supposed to play.
Okay.
But that's not where we're going to play. I'm going to mess something else up.
You got it picked out?
Yeah, I do.
All right. So can we sign off?
Yeah, you do that.
All right. So thank you so much, everybody, that's withstood us here for this painstaking 58 minutes and 34 seconds. I am Justin Underwood from the First Dibs podcast from inside Porsche Colorado Springs, and my co-host...
I'm John Deisty, and we'd really like a studio
and
some help and a sound studio so we can blast some music.
Absolutely.
So... Put me on your Christmas list or something.
Right.
Also, don't take financial advice from strangers.
That's right. And I'm glad, John, you're back.
Thanks.
Thanks, buddy.
Good night, everyone.
All right. So we're going to say quickly, Shift Magazine.
Yeah, Shift Colorado.
Shift Colorado.
The guys from Colorado Cars and Coffee. Brandon was the one with the awesome question about how bank rates are doing things.
Yeah, yeah.
So we got to get in there. Maybe we can take out an ad.
I'm sure. Well, are they doing that now? Because in their previous, in their launch magazine, there was not one ad.
Well, I mean, that was me winking. Like, an ad. Like, we'll pay Brandon to write a cool article about how awesome our podcast is. He'd be down with that.
Does Brandon write articles?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. No, he writes them. He edits them. He takes pictures. He does all of that. So, yeah. He could write about his experience down here being a guest on our show.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we could certainly
Need to get him hooked up with the steering committee guys. I think they'd have a lot of fun together, too.
They'd have fun. We got to get them back on the show.
Yeah.
I think they could definitely be a little bit, I mean, not every week, but kind of a regular spot.
Yeah. Yep.
Because they're just so involved.
Yeah.
You know, with car culture.
They really are. They really are. Yep.
So anyway, more stuff to conquer.
Yeah.
One step at a time, but we're getting there.
At least we still have a show.
We do have a show.
Nobody's canceled us. Which, when we started, I was a little worried about.
Sure. I understand. Yeah. I totally get that.
I didn't know who was going to cancel us, but
right.
Somebody probably should. Right?
Could. Somebody could.
Yeah.
Yeah. But until then, I think we keep enjoying our time.
We're a little early for it, but do you have any like New Year's resolutions or things you want to do for the next year?
No.
No?
I don't know.
Well, I just mean like goals for what we're doing here.
Oh, for what we're doing here with the show?
Not like you need to lose 15 pounds, buddy.
I've
got more than that. It's okay. But hey, I've had that for a while.
So
let's get that BMW out of the
In the course of the next year, I would like to see a legitimate studio space for the show.
Okay.
I would like to see legitimate recording equipment besides our phones.
Well, right? I think those are the right thing. They just shouldn't be our phones.
They should be someone
else's phone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree with that.
But permanent fixtures.
Uh-huh.
I like our equipment that we have. We just have to add to it a little bit. And I would like to see, I think I would like to start scheduling guests.
Yeah.
You know.
I think that's a good one. So we can tease it out a little bit. Weeks out.
You know, not 3 or 4 days out. Weeks out.
Yeah, I agree. Because our schedule is so busy.
Well, that, I mean,
no, but I think it should be.
And other people's schedules get super busy.
No, I agree.
But I think, you know, some of the guests that we've had over the past year have been pretty amazing, right? Renee Brinkerhoff with Valkyrie Racing was pretty awesome.
Yep.
If we could have her and her daughter, doing
that'd
a
be
show,
really fun.
That would be really fun because I know that they want to continue to do stuff.
Maybe we could do it from her restaurant.
Either a restaurant or even her garage. Like, she's got a pretty
garage. Oh, yeah,
garage.
She's got others. Yeah, cool stuff. Yeah.
A restaurant would be really fun, though. We could do something like that. I would certainly like to see... It would be fun to talk to Dave Battiti again. We still need to do our show with David Donner and Fred Veach that we've been discussing.
Yeah, in the car driving up.
In the car. We have to make that happen.
Yeah, we do.
Now that could go viral, right? Even if it's not going to be a 10-minute ride, you know.
Yeah.
But it could be like a 15-minute ride. Could you imagine?
No, I don't want that. Seriously, like that's wickedly fast.
I mean, when you're in the car with the best of the best.
Well, here's the thing. Part of the reason we want to do that is so they can play it back for clubs. And so the clubs can drive at their pace. We don't want the Mustang Club doing a 15-minute Pikes Peak ascent. Like that's not socially responsible.
Right.
We want it to be like probably 38 minutes, I think, would probably be just fine.
They'll make it more spirited.
Well, we can do another one with just us.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's always more fun to drive uphill than downhill. And yeah, going with those guys, I think driving uphill mm-hmm. would be an experience. Yep. And then let them exchange it and drive downhill. Mm-hmm. We could record it both ways.
Would we do it in a Taycan? Is that the right
thing? I think a Taycan Cross Turismo is the way to do it.
That'd be good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we'll put Danny in back with the mixing equipment?
Well, we have to sit somewhere.
No, like back. Right?
Just rolling around.
Yeah. He'd love it.
Uh-huh. Got to wear this mustache.
That wasn't his mustache? Oh, all right.
No.
Well.
It will be.
It should be soon. Yeah.
Yeah, so there's some cool ideas, you know, that we've had that we would really like to make just happen. And mm-hmm. I think this is the year to really pull that together.
So let's put some planning sessions together.
We got to do that. Yep. Some planning sessions. Obviously, we'll do some more shows with the steering committee guys. We'll go mm-hmm. up to Denver and do that. We need to have Tom on.
I know.
For God's sake.
Yep, absolutely.
We introduced steering committee Tom.
And now they're like, he's their like golden child. Right? He was just on again this
he's
week.
He's doing another show. Yeah.
Like, what the hell?
Yeah.
God.
Shit, Tom.
Yeah. Oh, talk about betrayal. Right? Yeah. Whatever. Yeah. It's all right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They live closer.
Drop the price of this car.
Yeah. Yep.
Geez. No, it's all in fun.
Oh, Brandon says he'd love to write the podcast.
Absolutely.
See him after class.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
All right. For sure. Yeah, mm-hmm. That'd be great.
No, that would be fantastic. And we should do a show. Yeah, we should pick a spot. I think doing some remote shows would be really fun.
Yeah.
Remote location stuff. Mm-hmm. That would be really cool. I really enjoyed. Jason has a new house. Is that right?
I don't know.
I think he's got a new place.
Well, good for him.
He was posting pictures of his new garage.
Hmm. Is there space for a Volvo that he could work on?
So I think we should do a show from there. I think we should do, you know, some people that we have not talked about recently that we should talk more about is Axe and the Oak.
Yep.
We should do a show from their spot.
Oh, that'd be really fun.
Just even at the tasting room on a Friday night.
Whatever, yeah.
When it's busy
and
there's noise in the background. Uh-huh. I think that would be really fun.
we can't do that on video.
Why not?
I don't know. It just seems like it'd be a problem. all right.
So there's all kinds of ideas with the show.
Yeah.
That would be, So we did.
Okay.
To your point, we need to sit down, plan some stuff out. Start making some phone calls, putting things on the calendar.
Let's do it.
And just advice from outsiders. Friday nights are tough for some people. So I think we should look at some scheduling. And it might just be airing, like mm-hmm. as far as your release dates or something. I don't know. For the show, there's a lot to work on, you know, over the next year. But I see it going way beyond that. Mm-hmm. Right. You know, I don't see, like you said, it's already been over a year.
Yeah.
You know, since we've been doing
it. Crazy.
And if anything, we get, you know, tomorrow or Saturday, we're going to ask, like, hey, you got any pictures for the show? Right? Yep. That's cool. Mm-hmm. That's great. Publish it out there. But having true studio space, having a lineup of guests that we know that are coming, having some skits, some ads, some real sponsors.
And I want to be more proactive on the cars. So
correct.
I just have some, like, B-roll that we can play while we're talking about stuff because maybe that's better than us doing live walk-arounds.
Yeah.
Or maybe we do both.
But maybe the listeners, you know, people watching, one of the things that we were told is that our just live action, just open concept that we've had from the beginning works really well for us versus it being super scripted.
Yeah. Well, I think that, you know, the car shows I love, Top Gear is number one, right?
Yep.
And even in Grand Tour 2, but it's kind of scripted, but the only reason it works is because the three of those guys are just such good friends.
Right.
And I think that's what works with us too, is we're just, we like each other. We're not getting paid, but we are hanging out and, you know, that's okay with us.
Yeah.
So.
No.
I don't know. What do you think? Should we call it a night?
Yeah, but real quick, I've given my 9-minute spiel on what I think for the next year. What do you want to see?
I think a lot of the same. just more forward planning on it, I think is going to make a big difference. Taking the time, you know, I think part of what we've been trying to do is get cars out there ASAP, right when they show up. But, you know, if a car is a week later, it's still 3 weeks before it hits the internet at large.
Yeah.
And maybe then we could have a little more time to plan it and talk about it and get pictures of it or whatever it is, to, I don't know, just do that. And then I think more guests, I think that can be really fun because I love when it, you know, just listening to the podcast I listen to, I love it when it's just the kind of core group of the people that, that run it. But it's nice to have kind of some other stuff because like the steering committee episode that I talked about, I had no idea that guy existed.
Sure.
I had no idea he was here in Colorado. I had no idea he was a huge car guy and Porsche guy, but really, really interesting. Just, I think they did a good job kind of asking questions and learning about this guy and then just getting out of the way.
Yeah.
Which to me is what makes a great host is letting your guest kind of shine through and not, you know, just talking over the top of them.
Right.
So I really enjoyed that. And I think there's so many cool people that we get to interact with, you know, taking some of our clients and bringing them on, you know, people that might be interested when we had Robin on, you know, that was great.
It was a great show.
Vote for Robin, everybody. If you're you're in the Porsche club, vote for Robin.
We got lots of really great feedback from that show.
Yeah, I think
people enjoyed Robin.
Yep. Yeah. So I think that's it, is just kind of taking it from, we were talking before the show, public speaking course that I took, impromptu, great at. Rehearsed things, not so good.
Okay.
And I think I'd like to push towards the rehearsed side of it, where maybe the show isn't rehearsed and scripted, but we've planned out what we're doing down the road. So we kind of have an idea of this is who's going to be on then. Maybe they've owned one of these, and maybe we can talk to them about this new car that we just had.